Sorry to the third lecture by Irene Valenzuela on the Swampland program listing compactifications. Please, Irene.
Okay, thank you very much. And welcome everyone to the last day of the lectures. So I received some requests yesterday of some things to tell, so I will try to fulfill this. And the plan is also to spend more time in some of the most recent conjectures that have appeared in the past few years, and what are the relations with the weak gravity and the distance conjecture. Before starting, let me ask also if there is any other question regarding yesterday or the previous day that you want to ask before starting with new things. Okay. I mean, if not, so yesterday we were discussing the distance conjecture. I was giving you different examples in the string theory compactifications in which this is realized, but all these examples were always with extended supersymmetry. Okay, we always had some moduli space. It was the scalar didn't have any potential. It was a flat moduli space, and then we were moving towards infinite distance limits in this moduli space. Now, if we want to apply the distance conjecture then to effective field theories, like inflation, for example, then we need to understand what happens if we add a potential, right? And we lift this moduli space. So before getting to the other conjectures, I just want to comment a bit what happens when we add a potential and what statements remain true or not. Okay. So there was some refined distance conjecture. It's not very clear sometimes what we call the refined distance conjecture. I would say that what it means is that we expect that this exponential behavior that we are describing for the infinite tower of states becomes manifest at Rasplanckian distances. Okay, and then that also is valid, I mean, that you should also get this infinite tower of states and the effective field theory should break down, even if you have a scalar potential, as long as the potential is not obstructing to reach the limit. Okay, so for example, you have like a runaway towards infinity, and you can reach these infinite distance limits with a nearly flat trajectory, then you should also satisfy the distance conjecture. If that's true, you can then try to apply to inflation because we have these nearly flat trajectories there. And then this is the, start editing, okay. So this is the bound that the distance conjecture predicts in terms of the cutoff. And for the particular case of inflation, then since the Hubble scale has to be at least smaller than the cutoff, what one gets is a relation between the field range and the Hubble scale. Since there is this logarithmic behavior and the Hubble scale for large field inflation is sort of close to the Planck scale, that's why usually we just say that this is a small lambda. This is just 1/λ, like some order one parameter in Planck units. But keep in mind that what the distance conjecture is giving you is a relation with the cutoff, okay? And not just a sharp bound, like a definite number. If one uses this for inflation, since the Hubble scale is related to the tensor to scalar ratio, indeed, there is just a finite region that is allowed for a slow roll inflation because there is a bound of the field range in terms of the tensor to scalar ratio and by the distance conjecture bound. And the answer, I mean, whether the distance conjecture rule out inflation or not, it depends on what model you're considering. So it doesn't rule out everything. I mean, you could have some moderate Rasplanckian field range. It really depends what is the value of this lambda. But it's true also that constrains some models. So there are some models, like for example, chaotic inflation or other models that would be outside of this region. Okay, so you just have to check, depending on the model, whether it's constrained or it's allowed. And for this, that's why I think it's very important to continue gathering evidence in a string theory in which we can really compute what is lambda. I try to understand what is if there is a model independent way to obtain it, like for example, if the tower is charged using black hole extremality. Okay, so the typical caveat for what I said is that the distance conjecture was applying to geodesics in moduli space, but when you have a potential, maybe you then the gradient flow trajectory doesn't go necessarily along a geodesic field distance, not a geodesic trajectory. So then what happens? Because in principle, the distance conjecture is not constraining non-geodesic trajectories. Now, for this refined distance conjecture to be true, so that this exponential behavior should be manifest when the field distance becomes transplanckian, doesn't matter if it's a geodesic or not, it means that we cannot engineer, I mean, for this to be true, it needs to impose constraints on the scalar potential as well. So, of course, if you just engineer any scalar potential of your choice, you can evade this because you can start doing very turning trajectories, right? And have a very large field range, even if the geodesic distance is very small. But the whole point of this refinement is that these scalar potentials that allow this type of trajectory should not be allowed in these asymptotic regimes. So if one wants to check whether this conjecture is true, it's not enough to consider only the field space, but you also need to study the scalar potentials. So the evidence we have for this and why Eran Palti started formulating this refined distance conjecture is based on flash compactifications of string theory. Because if you study type 2 FTOD Calabi-Yau flash compactifications, it seems that every time we go to these asymptotic regimes, even if we try to start with a very turning trajectory, like for example, we move only along an axionic direction, along an axion, the variation effects are going to turn this trajectory such that you cannot continue turning and turning when you approach the infinite distance singularity. So just to give you some example, if you consider n equals one flux potentials, okay, so we have these Calabi-Yau compactifications and we include fluxes, we can always rewrite the scalar potential in terms of, well, these are like some metrics for the three-form edge fields. These are the axions. So we can, since this is n equals one, the scalars come in chiral multiplets, so you will have some axionic that are periodic scalar fields and some partners, which we usually call the axions. And this structure is just due to gauge invariance. It's just because we want to preserve the discrete symmetries of the axions, right? That's a gauge redundancy that is not broken. The axions always appear in terms of some shift invariant functions that depend also on the quantized fluxes. And if you study this type of metrics that appear and this type of functions, what Eran realized for the first time is that when one computes this gradient flow trajectory, so you want to only move in an axion and keep this axion stabilized, then this is not possible because, in fact, the minimization of the scalar potential requires that for large distances, the same amount that you are moving in the axion, you are also moving in this axion. Okay. So this implies that if this happens, if this behavior appears, then the distance, the infinite tower that you have for the geodesics, for these axionic trajectories, it's also going to appear if you move on the axionic ones, even if they are not geodesics, because of the back reaction of the potential. So this was studied in type 2A flash compactifications and in Calabi-Yau and also in the complex structure moduli space of type 2B. So if just to say an example, if you have never sparse flux in type 2A, the scalar potential contains some this term. So this is H0 is the never sparse flux, S is the dilaton field, and phi is the axion that appears in the same chiral multiplet and the dilaton that comes from C3. So this is this is the terms that depend on the never sparse flux. And when you compute indeed the minimization of the potential, one gets that this axion is proportional to phi. So why this is happening? So this was just evidence based on particular examples, like checking different, no, putting different fluxes and see what happens in these models. But the underlying reason for this is that at the asymptotic limit, there is some homogeneity property that is satisfied, that is satisfied also in this example of the never bar flux. Okay. And this homogeneity property is giving rise to this sort of this behavior for the gradient flow trajectories. So I think this is also some open question of research now, like through, I mean, we have shown that this homogeneity property, I mean, was appearing in the asymptotic limits of F theory plus compactifications with G4 flux, but I mean, this was just a result using these limiting mishap structures and all these things, but there's no clear model-independent argument of why this would be true, or if it's just an artifact of this Calabi-Yau compactification, or if it's something more general. But if one is aiming to prove if the distance conjecture can apply for axionic trajectories and therefore be useful for inflation, one needs to address this issue and understand what are the potentials and whether they will satisfy this homogeneity property at infinite distance. Okay, so any question in the chat? No. Okay, so just to finish the distance conjecture, I put here some list of other open questions that we can further discuss on Friday. So just to give you some things that you can ask if you didn't have other questions. There are many open research lines in the distance conjecture, both, well, first to get more evidence beyond string theory compactifications, like for example with ADA CFT, and also some quantum gravity understanding, some more bottom-up understanding of why this should be true. And also in the context of string theory, try to really find out if there is always some weakly coupled, I mean, if any infinite distance limit is always some weakly coupled gauge theory limit, and compute what is always the value of lambda, and if there are universal bounds. And also the scalar potential that I was discussing now, what are the identified properly, what are the leading towers, if we can ever have something that is bigger than higher dimensional than a string. And there are also other versions, which are like a local distance conjecture in which the scalar fields also have a dependence on the non-compact dimensions and then understand what happens. So these are just open questions we can further discuss on Friday. So if there are no more questions about the distance conjecture, I will now switch to the most recent conjecture that have appeared in the past few years. Okay. Okay, good. So this is the map of conjectures that I started the lectures with. I have put in light blue the ones that I have not discussed yet. Okay. The other ones in blue I have mentioned, and the ones in black are the conjectures in which we have really spent more time understanding because they are at the core of the Swampland program. Okay. So these are the non-global symmetries, the distance conjecture, and the weak gravity conjecture, which are related, as we said, because they sort of the last two quantify how close we can get to the situation of recovering global symmetries. And the distance conjecture, the weak gravity conjecture, are related whenever the tower is charged. So there is some gauge coupling that goes to zero. And also through the scalar weak gravity conjecture. With the completeness hypothesis, it's also related to the weak gravity conjecture because if we have this sub-lattice or this lattice weak gravity conjecture, it's like also a refinement of the completeness hypothesis, no? In the sense that you are not saying just that you have a lattice of states of charges which are populated by physical states, but also saying that for each of them, at least there is one whose mass is smaller than the charge. So it's a refinement of how light they must be. And the trivial cohortizing conjecture and no free parameters also come as generalization of the no global symmetries argument. And we will discuss a bit more about them later on. Okay, so I think part of the message also of studying the Swampland program in string compactifications is that it's very important to test these conjectures precisely to get sharp and precise statements that can be falsified. That's part of the goal. So like, for example, for the distance conjecture, maybe it's not super surprising that there is an infinite tower that becomes light at infinite distance, but really identify what is the tower and really being able to compute how fast the mass goes to zero is important to be able to give a precise statement that can be used later on for phenomenology. So here I received a request, which was to, if I could summarize or explain a bit what are the main examples that have led to crucial refinements of the conjecture. And I think, I mean, this is a nice question. So I put here a list. You can have it for your, I mean, you can download the lecture notes. Basically, I should say I'm just repeating the examples I already discussed. So for the distance conjecture, the main examples that have recently appeared that are have been useful to improve our understanding of the conjecture are the examples that I described yesterday, based both on either towers or VP states that are becoming light at the infinite distance limits of type 2 and M-theory compactifications, and also all these tensionless strings that become light, no, these that become tensionless at the weak gauge coupling limits in F-theory. So these examples are important because they provide some systematic approach to rigorously test the conjecture for large classes of examples. So they are valid for any Calabi-Yau, so it's not just like take one particular, but relate the existence of the tower to algebraic properties that are satisfied on the Calabi-Yau compactifications, and therefore, you know, it will be they will be there in general. Okay. Now there is also, as I discussed now, there is this refinement of the distance conjecture, saying that it also applies to scalar potentials, and then the evidence comes only from all these flash compactifications on Calabi-Yaus and this asymptotic behavior of the scalar potential. So that's something that would be very nice to improve and to gather more evidence for. Okay. For the weak gravity conjecture, so the fact that we don't have only one state satisfying the weak gravity, but infinitely many, maybe forming a lattice or something like this, first came from this argument that we need to require consistency under dimensional reduction. So just by studying toroidal compactifications, you see that you need to have not just one, but infinitely many states. Now, at the beginning, this was formulated as a lattice with gravity conjecture because it was studied on toroidal compactifications, and then you always have lattices. But maybe something that I didn't remark enough is that the reason why now we call it a sub-lattice with gravity and not just the full lattice, is because there are some counterexamples which are precisely based on toroidal orbifolds, for example. So if you have a toroidal orbifold, here I just put in one example of a possible orbifold of T3 times C2 and C2 prime that act freely. So this sort of a rototranslation that have a rotation under one of the angles and translation along a different direction. Here in these examples, due to the orbifold, one is projecting out one of the KK photons. And the KK modes stay, but have non-trivial implications. So what happens is that, in fact, the KK modes associated to odd charge under this other KK photon receive a contribution from the KK modes under this first KK photon that is projected out, such that they are actually sub-extrema, so they don't satisfy the gravity conjecture. So there is only a sub-lattice of states, I mean, if this is even, if the charge is even, that satisfies the gravity. And this was like the first, I think, the first sample that made people think about it, together with the fact that when using modular invariance of the CFT, the argument using a spectral flow only allows you to say that there is a sub-lattice of states satisfying the gravity conjecture and not a full lattice. Okay, so these are, I think, the main examples. Of course, then also the examples I described above of the distance conjecture now also count as examples, and they were also constructed as examples for the weak gravity conjecture because the towers are charged. So in these cases, also what you get is not a lattice, but a sublattice, or sometimes even just a tower, because it's not easy to find out if there is a sublattice when you have all these BP states. But for sure, what you always have are infinitely many states, and they form sort of a tower structure. And the last sharpening that is for a weak gravity conjecture is that is all this interplay that we were discussing between the BPS bound, no force conditions, and so on, especially when we have scalar fields. And there is this sharpening that it can only be saturated when the state is supersymmetric, so it's BPS. So we don't have much evidence for this precisely because it's quite difficult to get control of over non-BPS states in string theory. But I'm going to postpone to review the evidence for this later on, because the next thing we will do is to discuss the ADS instability conjecture. And there this refinement is very important. So I will explain the evidence we have for it there. Okay, is there any question about this? Okay, so this is just sort of a summary of the examples that we discussed. Regarding the no global symmetries and coplanar hypothesis, I haven't written examples because there are no recent examples in string theory compactifications that have helped to refine the conjectures. I mean, there is a lot of work of using them now to get constraints on gauge groups and other things, but not to sharp the conjectures themselves. And in fact, in that regard, the best work I think has been done in the context of ADS-CFT, of trying to formulate precisely, at least in ADS-CFT, what are the global symmetries that are not allowed in the bulk. So this is the work by Hiroshi Oguri and Daniel Harlow. At least there are no published works about global symmetries in string compactifications, although I know there are many ideas going around, so maybe some of them will appear during the discussion on Friday. Okay, so let me come back to this map. So for the rest of the day, I'm going to discuss the ADS instability conjecture and also a bit of the Sitter conjecture. Okay. But before I want to say a few words also about what I wrote here, this emergence proposal. So together with all these conjectures, there has been some proposal based on emergence, which aims to explain or give a possible explanation of why these conjectures should be true, or at least some of these conjectures, in particular the weak gravity and the distance conjecture. So I want to say a few words about it because it can be something that becomes more important in the future. The emergence proposal basically, it just notice that the weak gravity and the distance conjecture, they are giving you some relation between the kinetic terms, either the gauge couplings or the field metric, and so on, and the mass of some new states that appear, right? So the question is simply, maybe this relation is just due to renormalization group equations. It's just a matter of renormalization, right? We know that already we get relations, right, between the mass of massive states that have integrated out and the low energy effective theory Lagrangian by the renormalization group equations. Could be that the weak gravity and the distance conjecture are just pointing this and some sort of relation between these infinite towers and the field metrics and the gauge couplings. So the proposal is that indeed, the strong version of this proposal would be that indeed all the kinetic terms in the effective field theory are emerging from integrating out massive states up to some quantum gravity cutoff. So that when you integrate out all this tower of states that satisfy the gravity or the distance conjecture, you engineer the small gauge couplings or you engineer the infinite field distance. Okay, so the weak gravity conjecture and the distance conjecture go in this direction, then you, when you have very small gauge couplings and you have a very large field distance, you are going to find some infinite hour of states that is becoming light. And how light, it depends on how small is the gauge coupling or how large is the field distance. But the Merges proposal is going the other way around. It's saying, well, because you go, you are approaching some point in field space in which you get this infinite hour that becomes light, from the, in the infrared, you are engineering, no? This infinite field distance and this small gauge coupling. This strong version in which it tells you that or you cannot have these small gauge couplings or large field distances unless you are integrating out this tower of states, is quite strong in the sense that it says that all these fields are non-dynamical in the UV, like you don't have a kinetic term to start with, and you just engineer, no? All the kinetic terms emerge in the infrared. Somehow it's like what, I don't know, maybe for some people might not be surprising in string theory, no? That we expect sort of that maybe all the effective field theories that we write are already integrating out every massive state, no? That we have. But the proposal is try to make this more concrete, okay, and try to see whether we can understand this particular Swampland conjecture this way. So there are some very easy field theory computations that have been done that were hinting to this behavior. So for example, if I integrate out a tower of states up to the species bound of the tower, okay, where the quantum gravitational effects become important and I cannot do a quantum field theory computation anymore, then I'm going to engineer some small gauge coupling. So let's see how it goes. So the gauge coupling in the infrared, if I compute the one loop correction from integrating out the tower of states, are just given by the charge of the states, the log, the cutoff over the mass of the states. Okay, this is just the one loop contribution from a charged particle. And I have to integrate up to the species bound. Okay. So if you do that, since the species bound depends on the mass of the states, on the mass gap, this changes this logarithmic behavior, such that when you integrate the full tower, you get that this is equal to 1 over the time square. Okay, so this will be like from k equals 1. If you want, you can try to do this computation. I gave you in the first lecture what is the result for the species bound in terms of the mass gap. So you just have to plug it and do it in Mathematica, and then you get this result. And this implies that the mass of these states that you have integrated out behave proportional to the gauge coupling, to the renormalized gauge coupling in the infrared. And this is precisely the weak gravity conjecture. You will never get this behavior if you are just integrating up to some, if you are just integrating a finite number of fields. Okay, it's very important you have the full tower and that you are integrating up to the species bound of this tower. Now we can do the same for the field distance. So the one loop contribution to the scalar propagator, now it's given by the derivative of the mass of these particles that are running in the loop. And if we do the same game and I integrate out up to the species bound, then this is equal to the mass gap over delta m square. Okay, delta m, I'm just saying that I have a tower of states, and delta m is the mass gap, okay, in this tower. So again, this implies that if I now compute the proper field distance, which is the integral of this metric, this renormalized metric, then this is equal to the logarithm of the mass of the states, which is precisely the distance conjecture. So again, if I integrate out only a finite number of fields, I will never get an infinite distance divergence. But if I integrate the full tower, then this behavior becomes this, well, give rise to this logarithmic behavior of the mass. So when the mass goes to zero, I engineer, no, I create this infinite field distance. So these are toy model computations. I mean, it's just, it's just a nice motivation to make you think that maybe there is something behind this emergence proposal. But of course, it's very complicated, and I think it's one of the, it would be very nice to have to make progress on this, is to make these things more concrete, in particular string compactifications. So this is fine, for example, if we are integrating out BP states, because then we can trust of using, of taking into account only this one loop computation. And indeed, in the complex such a moduli space of type 2 compactifications, it's known that the singularities can be understood as integrating out the BP states and the metrics and the gauge couplings. No, you can also, you can match the geometric result that you get for these couplings to the field theory result that you get from integrating out. So it's consistent, but going beyond the complex structure moduli space, yeah, it's more complicated, and whether it's always true, it's an open question. Okay, so this is the proposal. If you want to repeat these computations and you don't get them, I mean, you can ask me about it. And now we are gonna start with the ADS instability conjecture. Okay, any question? No? Okay. So the ADS instability conjecture, well, it was appeared in these two papers a few years ago. In the second one, it was remarked that it was not only ADS. In the first one, it was more based on ADS, because it's where I think it's more surprising that you don't have necessarily a, I mean, you might have expected that you have some non-supersymmetry vacuum which is stable. But in a very few words, what it says is just that any non-supersymmetric vacuum should eventually decay. Okay, so it can be very long-lived, but eventually it has to be unstable. So that's why I wrote here that can be metastable. Okay, so you can, it doesn't mean that you need to have some perturbative instability. Maybe it's just a non-perturbative one, in the sense that you have a lower minimum to which you can decay to. Now, it's true that typically we get instability when we break supersymmetry, but it's not trivial at all that we always need to get them. Okay. Especially from the point of view of quantum field theory. So the motivation for this conjecture is twofold. One is based on the weak gravity conjecture. So the thing is that the weak gravity conjecture can provide some decay mode for these vacua whenever they are supported by fluxes. So consider that we have an ADS vacuum that is supported by fluxes, meaning that I have some gauge fields in the extra dimensions. Okay. These are the fluxes, which stabilize the scalars and generate a minimum in ADS. Now, these fluxes are dual to top form gauge field strength and Hodge dual to this gauge field strength. So I have in D dimensions, this is the space-time dimension, I have a C D minus one form gauge field. And then if we apply the weak gravity conjecture for these fields, what it says is that I need to have some charge D minus two brain, okay, some electrically charged brain, which is going to be a domain wall. Okay, just the domain wall, I just mean that the codimension is one, okay, of this object. And according to the weak gravity, it needs to satisfy that the tension is smaller than the charge in Planck units. Okay, smaller or equal than the charge. Now I'm applying here the weak gravity conjecture to these non-dynamical gauge fields in lower dimensions. You can also apply, you can get the same result if you apply the weak gravity conjecture to the Hodge duals of these cage fish in the extra dimensions, which means that you need to have some D minus P minus 2 brain. So this is the total space-time dimension that is charged under these hot dwarfs. And when dimension is reducing on the dual cycle, we get these D minus 2 brains I'm talking about. Okay, yes, you can think of it in higher dimensions or in the lower dimensional theory. Okay, so this is something very typical. Whenever we have flashes, we know that we have these domain walls. We have domain wall of charge Q, which are interpolating between different flash vacuum. So on one hand of the on one side of the domain wall, I have a vacuum with a flux F, and on the other side, I will have another vacuum with flux F plus Q, just because of charge conservation. Okay, so what is the problem with that? Okay, so the fact that we have these domain walls, of course, is not new. The interesting part is that the weak gravity conjecture constrains what is the tension of this membranes of these brains. Okay. So if we now take this sharpening of the weak gravity conjecture that I was talking about, that we introduced the first day, saying that the weak gravity conjecture can only be saturated if and only if the state is BPS in a supersymmetric theory, then we are going to have non-trivial implications for the stability of the vacuum. So as I promised, I wanted to summarize here what examples and evidence from string theory compactifications we have for this sharpening of the weak gravity conjecture. And I can do it because, as you can see, there are not many, because it's a very important problem by itself, not to understand better non-BPS structures and non-BPS states in the string theory. But there are some. So the typical example is the first one I gave you for the weak gravity conjecture, which was heterotic string theory on this Narayan compactification, so toroidal compactifications, in which, since we have a worsted description, we can compute the perturbative spectra, including non-BPS states. And there, it's known that these non-BPS states are strictly smaller than the charge, so they do not saturate the weak gravity conjecture, but they are super extremal with respect to the charge to mass ratio of extremal non-BPS black holes in that theory. Okay, you can see there is a question. Is it correct to say that this motivation only holds in 2A, because in 2B, I cannot stabilize all moduli by using fluxes? Is there a way to motivate this conjecture if the ABS vacuum comes from A to B? I don't think you need to stabilize all the moduli for this. So the idea is just that even if you are stabilizing other scalars with other sources, if you can connect, so you have some vacuum and you have you can have some domain walls, no, some brain that is interpolating between different flash vacua, so that you have some subsector of the theory in which you can have different vacua depending what are the values of the fluxes, and then you can have a domain wall interpolating between them and relating the different values of the fluxes. I think it's still valid. So the idea is that you need to have some fluxes so that you can apply the weak gravity conjecture, and those fluxes have to stabilize the moduli in the sense that they have to change what is the value, what is the vacuum that you are in when you cross the domain wall. Okay, but it cannot be completely decoupled. Okay, any other question? Also, you can choose to write in the chat or unmute yourself, whatever you prefer. I'm completely fine if you just start talking and I have to stop to answer. Okay. Okay, so the heterotic string theory is one of the typical examples. Then we also have very recently all these nice examples using these strings that become tensionless at the weak coupling limits, because there the spectra is also non-BPS. And for example, this is the formula that I gave you yesterday for the case of F3D compactifying to 6 dimensions. And again, here, they are super extremal. So, these are non-BP states in which they are a bit super extremal comparing to the black hole extremality bound and also the no force conditions that you have in this setup. Now, there is also motivation from studying higher derivative corrections to non-BPS black holes in the hadronic string theory to show that they go in the direction of satisfying the weak gravity conjecture. And also there is an argument that, well, if you remember, if we have scalar fields, these scalar fields contribute to the extremality bound. Okay, so this part here depends on the scalar fields. And this is, I mean, if the scalar fields are massless, this is now the weak gravity conjecture that one has to saturate or not. So this is the bound. But if we now break supersymmetry and provide a mass for these scalars, then they are not going to contribute anymore to this extremality bound. So if you have some states that were saturating the bound before generating the, no, before generating the mass and before breaking supersymmetry, then typically, I mean, now since they are not going to contribute anymore to alpha, the charge of those states is going to be strictly bigger than the mass, which is going to be the new extremality bound that you have to satisfy. So the presence of scalar fields also helps. I mean, the fact that we know that when they are massless, they have a positive contribution to this extremality bound also helps to satisfy this sharpening whenever we break supersymmetry, especially if we now start studying lower compactifications, no, in which we always get this behavior for the extremality bound, but we will not have anymore some scalar that compensates this. Okay, so it would be very nice to try to gather more evidence. It's also nice that if this sharpening of the weak gravity conjecture is very concrete in the sense that if it's correct, it's also even predicting new things that we should be able to compute in string theory. For example, I mean, we can try to think of other examples in which we would have non-BPS particles. So if we have M-theory on K3, we can wrap M2 brains on non-holomorphic curves. And then if the conjecture is true, it means that the mass, no, that is associated to the area of the two cycle has to be smaller than the charge, which is the integral of the Kähler class. So if one could prove this in the context of the geometries and the string compactifications, it would be a very important evidence for this conjecture. And also for the case of M-theory and G2, right? Because we get to N equals 1 and we don't have BPS particles there. So are they satisfying this strict inequality of the gravity conjecture? That's some interesting question to answer. Okay, so assuming this, okay, let's assume that this holds, okay? Now, this has implications for the instability of the vacuum. Why? Well, we said that we need to have, if we have fluxes in a compactification, we need to have a brain, a domain wall, which interpolates between different plus vacua, whose tension is smaller or equal than the charge. But now, if the vacuum is non-supersymmetric, this opening of the weak gravity conjecture implies that this domain wall satisfies this strict inequality, so that the tension is smaller than the charge and not equal. And then this is going to describe a bubble instability in ADS. Okay, so this is a false vacuum decay. Well, this is, I mean, it can be understood just because of energy conservation. So the thing is that if the tension is equal to the charge, you are going to get a straight domain wall that interpolates between different vacua. But if the tension is smaller than the charge, the cost of energy of expanding the bubble is smaller than the electric repulsion. So you can indeed nucleate this spherical brain, and the bubble will start expanding, describing an instability. And inside you will have an ADS with less flux. Okay. Of course, you can also compute what is the instanton solution mediating this process. And here I'm not being very careful about whether we have scalar fields or not, but it's known that at least in the probe approximation, in which I can sort of neglect the back reaction of the scalar fields when I go away from the brains, then the instanton solution exists only if the rate, I mean, only if the tension is more than the charge, because the tension of this bubble satisfies this formula, and this is always smaller than one. So I can only have a finite radius for the bubble if the tension is more than the charge. I want to remark it again, this is assuming this sort of probe approximation, okay? That one can sort of neglect the back reaction of the scalars. And by energy conservation, we expect that this is still true. I mean the cost of energy of expanding the bubble, no? Will be smaller than the electric repulsion if the tension is smaller, but it would be nice to have better computations, I mean, more rigorous computations in this regard, taking into account the variation of the scalar fields and other things. Okay, so this is the motivation for the conjecture coming from the weak gravity conjecture. So as you say, it's based on this sharpening. But you could also ask, okay, what happens now? I mean, the conjecture is talking in general, right? What happens if I don't have fluxes, for example, and I cannot use the weak gravity conjecture? Is there any other way to argue that any vacuum will always be unstable? And there is indeed another way to look for instabilities, at least as long as you have extra dimensions, okay? But even if you don't have fluxes, or I mean, doesn't matter what ingredient you have. And this other decay mode is a bubble of nothing. So I want to ask again the participants, let's see how many reply or how many are listening, if any of you know what is a bubble of nothing. So you have to click yes or no. Okay, good, I see replies. Okay, this is more half-half actually. Okay. So a bubble of nothing is literally a bubble in which there is nothing inside that pops in space-time and starts expanding at the speed of light, so that it describes a non-perturbative instability from the vacuum to nothing. So the vacuum annihilates itself. Okay. Now this sounds very exotic, and if you have not heard about it, and it seems completely singular. I mean, how come you are going to generate a bubble in which there is nothing and there is no space-time inside? And the reason why it's a regular solution and it's a completely fine instanton Euclidean solution to the equation of motion when you have extra dimensions is because when you have an extra dimensions, this solution exists if this extra dimension is shrinking to zero size at the bubble wall. And that's what allows to have a smooth, geodesically complete solution from the point of view of high dimensions. So this was already pointed out by Witten many years ago for a Kaluza-Klein compactification. And this is the main point, okay? That you have some compact internal space that shrinks to zero size at the bubble wall, and then this bubble with nothing inside will start expanding. So to understand whether you have this bubble instability, you need to understand whether you can shrink your compact dimensions. Okay, so for example, this is the case of S1, in which we are shrinking to a point. But more generally, you could think of any compact dimension of dimension D and ask whether you can actually shrink it to a point to generate a bubble of nothing. Okay, so whether this can happen, so whether at least I can shrink this manifold stop point, and whether I can do this, whether this is topologically allowed, whether I can have a topological solution that allows for this, is something that is can be very precisely answered. In the sense that this will happen whenever this compact manifold can be written as the boundary, right? A manifold of one dimension more, right? So here, right, I have a, well, there is a B2. Here, D plus one. So whenever I can fill the circle, so here what I do is to have a disk, right? So the boundary of a disk is the circle. So whenever I can write my compact manifold as the boundary of another one, then I can shrink it to zero size. And this is something that is possible whenever your favorite compact manifold belong to the trivial class on board this in group. Where here you need to put, if you have fermions, for example, you need to put structure, like some spin structure, and this spin structure needs to be preserved in this higher dimensional manifold. Okay, so you might need to, depending what is the structure that you might have, what is the fermionic structure and the fluxes and so on, you need to consider a different Bordesian group. I think there is a question. Sorry, I might get it wrong, but can you explain how does wrapping deep brain around holomorphic cycles make states to satisfy BPS condition? In the end, whether you have a BPS state, if you are starting from some deep brain, some BPS deep brain, you can understand it in terms of the geometry, if you are wrapping some representative, some holomorphic cycle. Right, so that you can preserve supersymmetries in lower dimensions. And so if you wrap a non-holomorphic cycle, any other cycle, then we are not going to preserve supersymmetries and you are going to have a non-BPS state in lower dimensions. It's not obvious at all whether this saturates the weak gravity. It's a BPS state if it's a holomorphic cycle, but maybe it's not. Is not necessarily extremal, and that's where all this interplay between BPS states and extremality is very important to understand better. Okay. Yeah, I think. Okay, so coming back to this. This Bordesian group, I discussed a little bit about them the first day, but you have also heard more about it in the context of anomalies. And yes, to remind you very quickly, it's just that it's an equivalence relation, so two manifolds are Bordesian to each other if they are the boundary of another manifold. So the one that belongs to the trivial class is precisely the one that is a boundary by itself. So that's our bowl of nothing, the trivial class. Now, very recently, there was this Swampland conjecture that I mentioned the first day by saying that the Bordesian group of quantum gravity has to be trivial based on the absence of global symmetries. Okay? Because otherwise, you can understand these non-trivial classes as global charges that would be inconsistent with the statement that there are global symmetries in quantum gravity. So this conjecture was implying that any EFT is always related by some finite energy domain wall, but also that since all of them belong to the same class and it's this trivial class, it also means that any compact manifold that can be shrink to a point, so that there is no topological abstraction to have these bubbles of nothing. Now I will not discuss more about it, but it's important to notice that this is just a topological condition. So then you also have to solve. So it's like requiring charge conservation when we study the domain wall for the weak gravity conjecture. Okay. Now you also have to require that indeed the bubble will expand. So you need a dynamical you need to have a dynamical, it has to be dynamically allowed to expand, okay? And then there are many more things you have to study. And in fact, we've seen that these dynamical conditions are related to some local energy conditions, which are generically violated when you break supersymmetry. And in fact, when you have fraxes, they become again related to the weak gravity conjecture. So this is something to explore in the future, whether we can use this power of nothing to prove that any non-supersymmetric vacuum will always be unstable. Okay, I can see another question. Omega quantum gravity would imply that, for example, there is a spin defect that makes the periodic circle null bordant. What plays the role of this defect? Yeah, of course. So, exactly. So for the Wittes bubble, for the S1, in principle, we couldn't have a bubble of nothing if we have a fermions with periodic boundary conditions, because then omega 1 of spin, right, happens is that omega 1 spin is C2. So there are some, the circle with periodic boundary conditions belongs to the non-trivial class. According to this conjecture, there should be a way to add some spin defect here, so to change here this structure, such that everything belongs to the trivial class. And then, in principle, then you could also construct a bubble of nothing in that case, even if you have periodic boundary conditions, if you include a spin defect, okay, in the core of the, in the tip of the bubble. Now, the problem is that if you do that, these UV defects are you cannot describe them with the supergravity approximation. So the semi-classical description of having some instanton solution and semi-classical instability breaks down. And it's not easy, I mean, because you don't have a smooth solution anymore. But, so it's difficult to construct explicitly, no? What is the instanton solution and what is the decay rate and compute the decay rate for that process. But in principle, there is no topological obstruction anymore. So it might be there. We don't know what would be the decay rate, but it should be there according to the conjecture. An example of such a defect in string theory. Some spin defect. Let me think. I'm not sure right now. Maybe can I think of spin C? Because usually the fermions are charged. I cannot remember right now. There are some for sure, and I can check later on or let you know. But also in the paper of Jake and Kunru, they have a list of many examples in string theory and how you can always find some defect to make this Bordesian group trivial. So maybe there is some example there. We can try to check later on. Yeah, in type 2 compactifications, this would be, I mean, you have omega, you have omega spin that is relevant there. And yeah, maybe there are some examples. Okay, any other question?
Yes, I would have a question. So yes. why actually is so basically the, if I take this compact manifold, in the end it's coordinates to a point. So why does it imply that I have a bubble of nothing? Can I not have the four-dimensional manifold times a point instead of the bubble of nothing?
Well, but the thing is that I mean, it's just that you can have this. I mean, it's just that if you are looking, I mean, in order to look for this bubble of nothing, you are looking for a Euclidean solution to the equation of motion, right, of your theory, some instanton solution. And this instanton solution, in order to be smooth, I mean, since you have a hole in the space-time, you need to have some extra dimension that is shrinking there. So if, I mean, it's a, in order to show whether you can have it, at least topologically, you need to study whether you can shrink these manifolds. Then whether you will have it or not, you need to study the dynamics and other things, because you need to show that you can have a metric and that there is really a solution in which you have a bubble with a finite radius. And that's not trivial at all. So it's a necessary condition, but not sufficient condition. Yeah, does it answer your question?
Yes, thank you. Thank you very much.
Okay. But it's already a lot. I mean, because before we thought that, I mean, with this Witten example, we thought that as long as we have boundary conditions that preserve supersymmetry, all these bubbles of nothing were going to be forbidden topologically. So even if we break supersymmetry at low energy, then and the bubbles of nothing were not going to appear. And now, since you, if you are able to get rid of this topological obstruction, then it's much more likely that you might have these bubbles of nothing whenever you break supersymmetry, because now it's just a matter of dynamics. And even if you just break it a little bit, maybe that's enough to have a bubble that pops in. Okay. So let me just finish this conjecture and then go to the sitter for the rest of the time. So there are some examples in which, in fact, it has been useful to study this bubble of nothing to find out what is the instability that appears when we break supersymmetry, because it was not clear what it was otherwise. And this list probably will continue increasing in the next years. So the implications of this, and I will finish this conjecture, is, well, obviously, it has implications for non-supersymmetric holography in the sense that an instability in the bulk is instantaneous in the boundary because an observer in the boundary has access to infinite volume of the bulk. So if you have an instability, there is no unitary CFT, which means that if we have some non-supersymmetric CFT, it cannot have an ADS dual, which is weakly coupled to Einstein gravity. Okay, so all these conjectures, I mean, right now, all these instabilities are valid for Einstein gravity. So what it means is that non-supersymmetric CFT have to be dual to something that does not have a large N or a large gap. Also, it's possible to get implications of this conjecture for our universe as well, like for the standard model of particle physics, because even if we don't live in ADS, if we compactify the standard model of particle physics to lower dimensions, we can generate ADS vacua in lower dimensions, which are not supersymmetric. So if these vacua are unstable, they would be inconsistent with the conjecture and would hint that the standard model itself is inconsistent, which doesn't make sense. So the way to avoid this is to forbid the presence of this vacua, which requires to have a relation between what is the value of the cosmological constant and the neutrino masses. Okay. So if they are stable, it would be a problem, and you can get rid of them if the cosmological constant is bigger than the neutrino mass to the fourth, which is the numerical coincidence that we observe in our universe, and would also imply that the electroweak scale is smaller than the cosmological constant over the Yukawa coupling. Okay, so I mean, this is not, I mean, it's a proposal, but it's not a complete solution to the hierarchy problem, because of course we need to prove the conjecture, and also it's assuming that there is no another way to make this vacuum unstable. But it's just a proof of principle of how these conjectures might be useful to change our logic of naturalness, and how the fact that not all the space of parameters are necessarily consistent with quantum gravity can change these hierarchy problems and these intuitions. So that's a potential implication of the Swampland conjectures that, at least in the long term, would be nice if they can really provide an explanation for all these hierarchy problems and naturalness issues. Okay, any other question? Okay, so the rest of the time.
Sorry, Irene, I have a stupid comment.
Yes.
So about the bubble, it's not really a question, but about the bubble nothing. There are, some people have argued that it's, since you said, oh, it's a different channel, some people have argued that it's a limit. So you should think of it as a limit.
When you have fluxes? Yeah, I mean, it's a different channel in the sense that you can have it even if you don't have fluxes. But
I understand. So I have in mind the paper by Brown.
Brown, yes, yeah. So if you have fluxes,
I have a sequence of next to nothing.
You can understand the bubble of nothing, at least in these examples, as getting rid of all the flux at the same time, right? Instead of nucleating a brain and getting rid of one unit.
Right. Yeah, that's the first paper. Then there's nothing. Then there's another paper that is called On Nothing, where they.
No, I think that's.
They say that you can think of it as having a sequence of bubbles, which where the curvature radius is smaller and smaller until there's nothing.
Yeah. No, so I think.
In that sense, it's almost the same.
In that sense, it's almost the same. Although I think that has only been shown to work if when you are getting rid of the flux, you are sort of going towards small radius. Like, for example, in all these ADS compactifications, you have some spheres, and then you have a contribution from the curvature of the sphere, so that if you get rid of the flux, you have a runaway towards zero. It sort of makes sense that then you have this, you can understand the bubble of nothing as the end point, as the deeper ADS vacuum that you could get. It would be nice to have evidence for this beyond that, like even if you don't have these runaways. And in that case, I think it might be true that the bubble of nothing in the end is always this end point of all these step-by-step decays. But it's also true that you can also have the bubble of nothing even if you don't have fluxes or anything like that. That's why it's more universal. Okay, any other comment or question? Okay, so let me say a few words about the Sitter conjecture. And what is the status of this? So it's an open question whether string theory admits for a de Sitter vacuum or not. It's not ruled out that it does, but it's also true that there is no full-fledged top-down de Sitter construction in a controllable regime yet. And that's a challenge to achieve and something that we should spend much more time working on, I think. So based on these themes and some Swampland relations with other conjectures, it has been proposed very recently, all these controversial conjectures sometimes, that there are no de Sitter vacuum in string theory. And there are different refinements. So usually they sort of imply that you have this condition on the slope of the scalar potential so that it doesn't allow for a de Sitter minimum. And there are some shortcomings of whether you also have a constraint on the second derivative so that you can have extrema but not minima. And then also this Trans-Planckian censorship conjecture, it only imposes that you don't have a de Sitter minimum at the asymptotic boundaries of the moduli space. But you might have a de Sitter minimum deep in the bulk as long as this de Sitter minimum is short-lived. I mean, it's not very long-lived. So it gives a constraint on the decay rate of the de Sitter. Now, from the point of view of string theory compactifications, what we can say is that, I mean, we can gather evidence at least for an asymptotic version of this. So I like to call it asymptotic de Sitter conjecture because it's only valid when I am in this large field limits, okay, in these asymptotic regimes of the moduli space, when the tower of the distance conjecture is becoming light. So in these limits, we could have the statement that when we approach the limit, also the scalar potential has to behave in a particular way, such that we have this runaway behavior. With some order one factor. Okay, so when I approach these limits, I get these runaways, and this is sort of a generalized Dein-Seiber problem, right? That we cannot generate a minimum and stabilize if we are at these classical regimes. But it's generalized in the sense that it says it applies for any infinite distance limit that I could have, okay? Not just for the string coupling, but any scalar direction of my field space, of if in the effective theories of the space of parameters should satisfy this behavior. So this is, I mean, I like this because this is something concrete that we can check. because precisely in these regimes is where we have control, right, about what are the low energy effective theories that arise from string theory. And in fact, most of the string theory, many models of string phenomenology, they are always working in these regimes because you are always at large volume or weak coupling or something like that. So you are always at some asymptotic regime in the field space, even if you didn't call it that way. So it's useful to understand if this is always true in order to apply to this, all these models, but also it's something that we can really check and try to understand why this happens in the same way that we did with the distance conjecture, trying to identify the infinite tower of states. So there is indeed a relation between the de Sitter and the distance conjecture. There is an intuitive, a physical relation, and then also a relation in terms of the geometry. So the physics argument is that maybe that indeed the distance conjecture is responsible for the runaway, so that this behavior of the potential is emerging, no, from the contribution of this infinite tower of states. And a way to obtain this is that the argument that was given by Kumru, Neran, Hiroshi, and Gary is that the if we compute the entropy associated to this infinite tower of states, okay, which is going to depend on the number of states that you have and the de Sitter horizon, and impose that this is smaller than the Gibbs-Hawking entropy, okay, which is just given by the de Sitter horizon, so 1 over the vacuum energy, the cosmological constant, then if the potential is nearly flat, so we have like really almost a quasi de Sitter, this potential is just scales as the cosmological constant, and this is going to imply that it goes exponential in terms of the field distance when we use that the number of states here increases exponentially with the field distance. Okay, so that would be a consequence of having the tower. From the point of view of string theory compactifications, there is indeed evidence for this, because even much earlier than this conjecture, there are several no-go theorems that appear for classical de Sitter vacua whenever we stabilize the moduli at the perturbative level, okay, not using non-perturbative effects or other things. So these no-go theorems usually apply to type 2 with fluxes and different sources of DP brains and oriented four planes, and there are different no-goes in the sense of depending what ingredients you are putting exactly and what the brains and orientifors and whether they are parallel or not, you get different no-goes. But I want to remark that many of them, if not all, are based in fact on the scaling of the moduli and of the potential at these asymptotic regimes. So just to give one example, so you have one example in mind, I think the most famous one, because then all of them that came afterwards are sort of generalizations of this, is what happens when you have type 2A on a Calabi-Yau threefold at weak coupling and large volume. So if we have this compactification, the scalar potential, so all the scalars can be stabilized, or the model can be stabilized with fluxes, and we have the contribution from never sparse fluxes. And here I'm going to write, as usual, what is the dependence on the volume, rho, and the dilaton, tau. Okay, so just thinking of the weak coupling and the large volume behavior. So this is the behavior for the never sparse flux, for the Ramon-Ramon fluxes. Gets this contribution. And then we have the localized sources, right? So we have the D6 brains and the orientifold planes. And the no-go is just based on these powers of the moduli here. So what is this scaling behavior? Because if you now compute the minima, so you try to minimize the scalar potential, you can see that the derivative satisfy this relation. Okay, so the derivatives are always bigger than an order one factor times the scalar potential, because this contribution is always positive. And this implies that we cannot stabilize the moduli in the sitter, right? Because if we want this derivative to be zero, this is not possible if the vacuum energy is positive. Now, all these other no-go theorems are basically modifications of this, adding more ingredients. And in general, you get sort of a no-go of this type again. So there's some relation between the derivatives and the potential itself, because the different terms in the potential are sort of are monomial functions on the moduli. And this, if this is satisfied, then you get the de Sitter conjecture with this order one factor. Okay. So one can try it, I mean, to check what are the different order one factors that appear, and try to find some understanding or some general rule for that. I want to remark also that these no-goes were always done in type 2, so they were always at weak string coupling. But one can also generalize this by going to FCOD plus compactification and just studying different limits in the complex structure moduli space of the Calabi-Yau 4 force. So by doing this, you can indeed check that the asymptotic potential at these limits also satisfies the Sitter conjecture using for any Calabi-Yau, so using again all these techniques of Hodge theory. And these are valid beyond string coupling. So it indeed hints that it's something not related to whether it's a string coupling or small coupling or strong coupling, but whether we are really approaching some infinite distance limit in field space. Okay, so much more work has to be done here, and as open questions, let me put here, open questions would be a better understanding of what is C, right? It's very similar to what happened with the distance conjecture originally, right? Like you just have many examples, but you need to understand to really prove that the potential always behaves this way and provide bounds for these parameters. And maybe some underlying principle of what the value should be. So indeed, maybe it's possible to relate it to the factor of the distance conjecture, because the tower at these runaways appear together. And in the end, it just depends on the geometry and the characteristic, not the features of these infinite distance limits. So indeed, in the end, they are all related. And from a more bottom-up perspective, in the same way that we were trying to identify this with the extremality bound using the gravity, these other factors might be also be related to the extremality bound, but of membranes that are the ones that are generating the scalar potential. Okay, so many open questions for the future. And I think I will conclude here. In case I had time, I was written the other two conjectures that have appeared. That it's still, I mean, they're quite recent, but there are also people working on this. I will not go into the details, just to mention in case you want to ask about them on Friday. So the idea is this as conjecture, which basically says that if you have some ADS vacuum, the limit of decreasing, of taking the cosmological constant to zero, the flat space limit of going to Minkowski, is actually at infinite field distance if we generalize our notion of distance to consider also metric configurations. Okay, so if we have a background metric, we have perturbations of this metric, we can try to define a distance on these metric configurations, and then the flat space limit is at infinite field distance in this space. So if you think this is sort of a generalization of the distance conjecture, and if you think if you take it this generalization, then you would get to the conclusion that you would need to have an infinite tower of states that become light at this infinite distance point. So they should scale as the cosmological constant to some power. There are refinements of whether what is this power, and It has been proposed a strong version in which this power is one half if the vacuum is supersymmetric, which would mean that there is no scale separation in areas, okay? Because then the scale associated to the mass of the tower, for example, if they are KK modes, will be of the same order than the areas scale. Okay, I see there is a question. Is this the Sitter conjecture somehow holographically related to the question of the existence of a 3D n equals 1 superconformable theory with an operator spectrum, such that some operators are very long conformal dimension? Almost. Yeah, you mean the ADS conjecture, right? I think.
I'm pretty sure he does.
Yeah, almost of the unitary ones.
Yes.
And there is a big gap, yeah. Yes, so exactly. So you can try to think of this conjecture from the point of view of ADS CFT. It's about whether you can have a large gap, right? So what is the, I mean, what is the operator spectrum that you have? And whether there is a gap, no gap to the higher dimensional, to higher spin fields, because it could be a KK tower, no? So whether how sparse is the spectrum, and whether you are sensitive to large extra dimensions or not.
Has someone ever tried to answer this question, maybe with bootstrap techniques or something like that?
You can read, there is a nice paper by Eric Permuter, and collaborators. In fact, they were interested in this question before this conjecture appeared.
Okay.
They precisely ask whether one can have large extra dimensions in ADS, so whether you have some scale separation or not, and whether you can put constraints on that. And it's not completely ruled out, but they have some arguments why, I mean, it doesn't happen.
Okay, thank you.
Can I ask you about this? What is the status following the papers by Junghans and your chairperson?
Yes.
Thomas Yellow and his friends.
So, yeah, I didn't say discuss here, but it's true there is a potential counterexample of this already in, I mean, that we know in string compactifications, which is in tight wave, with Roman mass and other fluxes and D6 and O6 planes. So, in this example, it seems possible to get an ADS vacuum which has scale separation. It's not violating this version, so still you have an infinite tower that becomes light in terms of lambda to some power, but it's violating the fact that alpha should be one half. Okay. There was a lot of debate about this, as you know, no? Whether this is a full top-down construction.
It was largely because of this know, smearing of the zoo plane.
So my take, Alessandro can correct me if I'm wrong, but my take of this is that there have been, I mean, some recent papers in which it has been shown that it's possible to go to the next order, so that this, the Wolf et al. Construction can be understood as the pseudo order of a perturbative expansion that doesn't have SU3 structure, no, but this is SU3 goes to SU3. And then it still satisfies the equation of motion, I mean, with these localized sources. But this is, I mean, they have only checked for the next order in this perturbative expansion. So it's just a non-trivial check that still works there. But I think, no, as far as I understand, one should try to understand what happens if you go to next orders, which, for example, would take into account the fact that the orienting force are intersecting, which is something, no, that is not present if you stay at first order in this perturbative expansion.
Yeah, in my view, we work in an approximation, so something could still go wrong. Not just at the next order in our approximation, but also because of string corrections when you go near the identical planes. I don't know, Junghans seems to phrase it a lot more strongly than we do. I don't think I agree on this stronger statement, but okay, that's my take.
Thanks.
Okay, so let me stop here. We can discuss more about it on Friday, on all these conjectures and what is the status about it and how to make progress on that. So this is the map, again, of the different conjectures. You can see that I'm writing many lines because indeed they are always related to some other conjecture, or I can just think of one of them as some generalization of another one in a certain setup or things of this type. It doesn't mean that if you prove one, you are proving all the rest. Okay, it's just that they are related in their different corners. But it can help to understand better what are the underlying quantum gravity principles that are behind, you know, all these Swampland criteria. So I think we can discuss about some of the others on Friday, but let me just finish with the remarks I made in the first lecture, in the sense that identify the possible universal criteria is only the first step. Well, I would say the zero step. Okay, they try to have some criteria that we think should be valid. But then comes all the hard work, which is to test these conjectures. So we have to, it's very important to continue testing these conjectures in string theory, to put them in more solid grounds and get sharp statements, no, that can be falsified. So we have to, I mean, we have enough evidence, I mean, we have enough compactification to start checking the conjectures and try to find out what are all these order one parameters and all these things, so that in the end we have something that has no ambiguities. And I think we should do it. And also then, if we are trying to understand whether this Swampland criteria is something beyond the lamppost, no, and is something more general of quantum gravity, we need to understand what goes wrong from a more bottom-up perspective, no, if some of these conjectures are not true. So to have some explanation, either using black holes, consistency of S matrix with unitarity, positivity constraints, or also with holography in general, why these conjectures are true. And then one can study what are the phenomenological implications and see if they can serve as guiding principles to construct new EFTs or solve some hierarchy problem. So I will stop here the lectures. And thank you for all the students to attend. And I hope you have more questions to ask. Let me also mention, I'm thinking, although it's not decided, whether I will type these notes properly and submit them to archive or not. But for that to happen, I would like to get some help. So it depends if there is any nice volunteer within the participant that would like to help typing, and maybe you can just contact me and we can talk about it.
Our student number one.
If there are no more volunteers. Yeah, you can just write me later.
Can I ask a last question, maybe?
Sure, ask any question you want.
Yeah, so I'm very curious about this bubble, about the finite.
It has to be the last one, by the way.
Sorry?
It doesn't have to be the last one. There can be.
Ah, yeah, of course. So I'm very curious about this bubble that you have about the finite number of aqua. So do you think Swampland can tell us anything about finite number of trifolds, Calabi-Yau trifolds?
So this is something I put it here because it's also some Swampland conjecture that appears also by Kunrun and Jonathan here, this thing, you know, that in the end, we should have only a finite number of aqua that should depend on the amount of supersymmetry that we have. It's related to whether we have a finite number of Calabi-Yau, right? it's I mean, one of the ways to make progress on that is precisely this way. I mean, we already know that it's possible. I mean, that we have finite number when we are thinking of elliptically fiber carabillos.
Yes.
Like, there are many interesting works there. So that would be a way not to show that. I mean, the end, the number is going to be finite. The problem of all these works is that it's very difficult to tell how many. I mean, it's easier sometimes to prove that it's finite, but to tell how many, it's much harder.
Mm-hmm. Okay, more in detail, I think up to homotopy type, they are classified by H11, H21, second chair class, triple intersection numbers.
Yeah, so is there any logic? No.
All manifolds, not just carabellas.
The thing is that there is no absolute bound.
We
know that, right, that we have less and less when these host numbers are large, but there is no absolute bound for these numbers. And in fact, if I correct, the way in which we know that there are finite number of elliptically fiber carabillos is because one can classify the base. No? It's just a matter of classification, no? The possible bases that you can have.
Yes, and that...
But indeed, it's something that would be very interesting to explore. If it is only a finite number, what they point out in this paper is that you only have a finite number of tunings that you can make in your respective theory. So that all these, maybe some of these sequestering ideas are not actually.
In fact, there's a mathematical conjecture that there is only one, depending how you count.
The Reed's
fantasy.
Reed's fantasy.
Yeah, that's a very nice thing. Course.
So when one says that there should be finitely many, does that count if they touch?
I have in mind this theorem of Wall that says that the homotopy type, up to homotopy type, they are classified by Dodge Diamond, second chain class, and triple intersection numbers. So if you can bound these four quantities, you are done, basically.
Wall's theorem is for any manifold, right?
No. For any Kähler manifold, I think, but it's phrased in terms of the Pontryagin class. So for Calabiau, just goes like with the C2, because C1 is equal to zero.
Yeah, in fact, it's kind of funny that the quantities that appear in Wall's theorem are exactly the quantities that appear in a low energy, in an equal to supergravity, because So you have, of course, the number of hypermultiples and retromultiples, which are H11, H21. And then there's the triple interception that appears in the leading term in the potential. And then the next, which is the second chain class.
Yeah.
I've always wondered what that means. Oh, we have a volunteer.
Three volunteers already.
Several.
We didn't put a cutoff on it, Irene, as you know. Kind of
one, two, three,
last
yeah.
With us.
There are other talks too, other lectures.
That's true, yes.
But they volunteered for this one.
You can send me thank you, all the volunteers. Send me an email so I have your emails and I can see, okay, whether we can organize this. So, yeah, just send me an email about this.
Jonathan comments, zero mode structure may differ if you pass through single transition. I mean, the multiples do change.
Maybe he's talking about like conifold transition will change your edge diamond.
No, which is what you mean, what you need for its fantasy.
Yeah. Actually, I think it's open question if everything can be connected by conifold or you need higher singularity, like with higher Milnor number, but I don't know.
Yeah, the only point I'm making is that when you write down a given effective field theory, you specify the collection of fields you want to talk about. So, you know, you would do...
All right, but suppose you have some branch structure in the spatial vector. Does that count as a single? When one says, "Oh, I wonder if there are finitely many vector,"
Well, I mean, I think when we were writing it, we were just assuming that, you know, you write down an effective field theory, assuming you're far away from any singularities in the moduli space, except possibly being at large volume. That's kind of the one you would canonically assume. But modulo that, then you write down the effective field theory. And with respect to that, you say all of the Wilson coefficients are then functions of the moduli in some form.
And yeah, although the transition also has an effective field theory description, which is Flamingo's.
Well, yeah, but you have to find a way to include or throw out various slight degrees of freedom when you do that. So,
right. Does that count or not?
Anyway. So that's that.
Any other question?
Alessandro, you the chair.
I didn't see any more questions. Students, ask questions. I command you. All right, I guess I can remind everyone that there will be also a discussion session on Friday, so if you can think about it and show up there and ask your questions, then we would be very happy. And if for the time being there are no other questions, so I guess we can stop the recording and